Hello, and welcome to Intuitive Nature, the podcast. My name is Susan Jane, and I believe that trusting your intuition is the best way to live your life with meaning and purpose. Each week, you will hear about how you can connect, develop, and trust your intuition through meditations, readings, and my own personal experiences. Join me to understand how your intuition can guide you towards a life full of meaning and loving purpose. Hello and welcome to Intuitive Nature, the podcast. I'm Susan Jane, Intuitist, and I'll be your host for this Intuition and Spirituality series. Now today we're going to discuss intuition and parenting so you can get it right for your child. Now, we know that intuition is a communication of our spiritual self to our physical self. Now, our spirit gives us intuitive messages in order to create some type of action or a response, and it will often help us in making positive decisions. Now, these messages can come through as a mental thought, a visual impression, an emotional expression, or even a physical feeling. But what happens when these messages appear to contradict what other people are saying? Now, when it comes to parenting, there is no secret book, but there is a secret to it, and you'll find out here. When you become a parent for the first time, you want to do everything right. So you'll gather as much information as you can. You will hook up with like-minded people. You will interact with women that are going through the same thing, that are also pregnant or trying to fall pregnant. You'll ask advice from others. You'll get advice given to you, whether you want it or not, which is what used to happen to in my case. But when I was a first-time parent, we didn't have the internet, so we had to get as much information as we could from the people that were around us. Now, there's positives and negatives to that. When we didn't have other people's opinions, like we might have had those that were close to us, but we didn't have access to a wider community like you do have with the internet nowadays, you were limited in how to raise your child. You raised your child that suited the environment that you were in, that was similar to how you were raised or how you perceived you were raised. And so you only had the information that you knew to go with. Nowadays, you have access to so much more information. And that is a positive, but it's also a negative as well. What happens is we get so much information that we do tend to get bombarded. In all this information, there's people saying, well, you know, you should do this or you should do that or try this or try that or if you want to do this, do that. And you start to get a little bit overwhelmed with it all. Now, I felt overwhelmed when I was a first-time parent and I didn't have that aspect to look at. I didn't have the feeling of being judged or criticized or on social media. I didn't have that. We did still have that feeling. You still got that feeling when you did things with your child that people would raise their eyebrows to. But we didn't have the online presence. We didn't have that aspect to it. So there was the positives and there was the negatives to it. So I actually feel for a lot of the young ladies now that are going through this because There's a lot of them that will take this information and they'll sort through it and get what they want out of it and then they'll move on. And then there's others that are trying so hard to do everything right by everybody else that they're not really enjoying who they are, their child, or anything about it. So there's a lot of aspects to that. Now, I remember when my baby was sick, I had had three babies in 3 years. And until I worked out what was causing it, and then I stopped. But at this particular time, the youngest one was quite sick, and I was still breastfeeding her, and I was quite concerned. There was a lot of colds going around, a lot of sickness going around, and the other two children had had it, but the youngest one wasn't feeding very well. Now, when you're breastfeeding, you're the only one who really has a lot to do with that child. If you're bottle feeding, other people can have more to do with the child, or the child's older, they may interact with the child more. But when this one was, she was only 3 months old, no one else was interacting with her the way I was interacting, obviously. And I knew she was sick. So I had contacted the lady across the road, who was a support and a friend, but she'd also done a bit of nursing. So I felt a bit confident in, I had more confidence in where she would sort of lead me, or the advice she would give me. I was two states away from my closest family member. I had no one else around me. So I was basically on my own, three children, alcoholic husband who was very rarely home. And I did a lot of it on my own. So it was a pretty tough time for me. And I asked the lady across the road if she could come over and just tell me what I needed to do. Just help me get through what I needed to get through. The kids were sick and I really wasn't coping very well. Now, again, she didn't have as much to do with the baby, but she saw the two toddlers. And straight away, she was very, very concerned for my son, who was the middle child. He had a cold and she said he was wheezy and he's probably got asthma. And she took me asking for support for my baby and she took it to a different level with my son. So all of a sudden, I was in this situation where I was concerned about this young 3-month-old baby. And she had put all this stress and concern about my 14-month-old son. It completely threw me because I knew he was sick, but he never stopped. For him to stop it, he would then be sick, but he just kept on going. He was full of beans, full of life, and he just kept on going. So when she sort of said that he could have asthma and he could just drop dead because he can't breathe, I went into a mild form of panic attack. I really didn't know what to do. I was so concerned for the baby because she wasn't feeding and I didn't believe she was breathing very well or very, you know, comfortably. She couldn't feed and breathe at the same time. But she had put all this concern onto my other child. So I then became even more stressed and felt more pulled in different directions. So she said to me, put him down for his afternoon sleep and see how he is when he gets up. If he's still wheezy or if he's still, you know, a bit sick, you'll need to take him into the doctor's or into the hospital. Now, we lived like 45 minutes away from the closest town, the closest doctor's. So it wasn't an easy trip to do that, especially with three young babies. So I put him down for the sleep, and while he was sleeping, I was really, again, concerned about the baby. She wasn't feeding. She wasn't settling. She just wasn't doing anything. She just wasn't running along the lines that I'd expected from the two before. My oldest daughter had had a sleep. She was fine. She, you know, a little bit sick, but nothing to be worried about. And basically, I dreaded the moment my son woke up, mainly because if he was really sick, I needed to do something with him, and I had to do that on my own with the kids, and it was really hard. It was a really tough time. But anyway, he woke up, and you wouldn't have thought he was even sick. He just doesn't stop. He just didn't stop. So then the worry again turned back to the youngest, and by now I was starting to get quite overwhelmed with worry about her. And again, no one else could see it because I was with her all the time. I was breastfeeding with her. I was with her all the time. I could understand. I knew that something wasn't right. Anyway, I had to go with my gut. I had to trust my intuition. I had to follow what I felt was the right thing to do. I understood that she was a nurse and she was concerned for the safety of one of my children. But I also could understand that I could see something different happening here. So I actually packed the kids into the car and I went into the hospital to get the baby checked. And What ended up happening was she had pneumonia on one lung, and we were in the hospital, ended up in the hospital for the next 2 weeks while she recovered. So if I had listened, and I did listen to what this lady said, because she was a nurse and she did give me some clear understanding, but I had to follow my own intuition. I had to follow my gut. I had no books to go with. I had no support to go with. There was no internet. There was nothing else. I had to follow my intuition. I had to follow what I felt was the right thing to do. And if I hadn't have done that, she was quite ill, but it could have been life-threatening. The first thing you've got to be mindful of about parenting is always follow your own intuition. Always follow what you feel is right by you. It is your child, and only you can really understand what your child needs or what is required. So that was sort of that aspect on it. As the children grew and became older, there was a time there when my child, obviously the three of them became teenagers, and because they were so close together, it was really horrendous. The youngest one liked to follow the oldest ones, of course, and I can remember this particular time when my eldest daughter was starting to go to parties, starting to go to events. Now, we lived on a 90-acre organic crop farm at that stage, so I used to have to drive them to different places. What we had was a situation with her friends and their parents. We would take it in turns. So one of the parents would pick them up, take them to the party, and then bring them home. And, you know, or they'd stay at their friend's place, and then we'd pick them up the next day. And then it was another time and I would do it. So we all took it sort of in turn so the girls could go to parties and still become adults, young adults. One of the things you've got to remember with the teenagers is it's all about empowering them. So this is the second aspect. You've learned to trust your own intuition. Now what you need to do is empower your child to trust themselves. Now, this is really quite challenging when they're getting information from all their friends. And as you can understand, as a teenager, they're going to be very, very much swayed by what other people say or do, or their friends say and do. So in this particular instance, my daughter wanted to go to the party. And so she came and asked me, can she go to this party? Now, again, I trusted mine, and for some reason, I just didn't feel quite right. I thought, no, there's an opportunity here to teach. So I said to her, who's going to be at the party? And she sort of rattled off a few names, and most of them I had no idea who they were anyway. But I said, and what about the party? Is it at somebody's house? So I asked a few of those regular teenage-y questions. She was a young teenager, so I asked those regular questions. And I said to her, well, how do you feel about the party? You know who your friends are. You know the sort of people that are going to be at that party. How do you think you're going to feel at that party? And she went, oh, Mum, it's going to be great fun. I'll be doing this and doing that. And so I let her go to that party, and it was fine. There wasn't a problem. But exactly the same thing happened probably a month or so later, and I got that same sort of feeling. And I went, okay, you want to go to this party? And I asked her the general questions again. And this time I said to her, so how do you feel about the party? The people that are holding this party, what are the types of people that are going to be there? How will you feel about going to this party? And she went, well, actually, Mum, when you put it that way, she goes, I don't like some of the people that I know would be going to this party. And I said, well, would you feel safe at that party? Because I'm dropping you off there. Are you going to feel safe there? And she went, no, actually, I don't think I will go. I don't think I will go. And I just made her feel how she would feel. I wanted her to understand what she was feeling, what she was experiencing. And I said to her, well, do you want your friends to come around here? We can go and pick them up and you can have a night here. And that's what we did. So we changed it around. But it made her understand her intuition a little bit better. It empowered her to trust herself. And I didn't say that she couldn't go or she, you know, she wasn't allowed to or she was allowed to. I mean, as a younger child, I did. But at this stage, I had to allow her to start to trust herself. I had to empower her so she could be strong enough to do it herself, strong enough to accept her feelings and go forward with that. Teenagers are all about helping them, empowering them to trust themselves, empowering them because they, look, if they don't know right from wrong as a teenager, by the time they've got there, well, then you've maybe not done something right. They know right from wrong. It's all about trusting themselves because if they can be strong enough in their own selves, it doesn't matter what anyone else or what their peers will say or do. So that's really important for a child. Now, the next part is I went through all that. I went through my divorce, separated after a 20-year marriage, and had to basically learn all that again. So what happened after being on my own for about 9 years, I met a man and he had a family. So then we're into this mixed families. By then, my children had left home. He had started later in his life, so he still had kids at home. I don't know how many of you have gone through the experience of having mixed families, having other people's children, but oh boy, it can be very challenging. And it can be challenging not because of the child. It's actually challenging because the way the child's been raised. We raise our children differently. We have this, there's so many variables. And as I said, when we're starting off with books and internet and everything else, how we do it and doing it right and families and generations and environments, all this type of things, all these variables come together and we raise our child or our children the way we do that. I had to do it with mine. You'll have to do it with yours. And your partner will be doing it with theirs. So one of the things that I found really challenging was he didn't raise his children the same way I raised mine. So they had got to teenagers and were a little bit unsure of right and wrong. Or they'd learnt to push the boundaries a lot further than what my children were allowed to push the boundaries. And again, it doesn't mean one is right and one is wrong. It just means that they're different. They're just raised differently, and I can't put my values onto how they are because they haven't been raised that way. I can keep my values to myself, I can learn trust myself, and I can still empower them, but I can't expect them to be as my children were because they are not my children. I can still love them, I can still engage with them, I can still teach them, empower them and support them. But I have to be mindful that they are not my children. So when you're involved with a mixed family, the best thing you can do, if you're not involved so much with raising the children, in my situation, the kids were sort of in their teens, so early teens, and one of the things that we had worked out in our partnership was that my partner did not want me to be their mother, and I did not want to be their mother. I married my first husband, and he had children already, so I'd already had teenagers. I had my own children, and I had teenagers, and now I'm going into this mixed family with more teenagers. I can assure you, I did not want to raise his children. Really, I didn't want anything to do with his children, but we did need to live together. We still needed to get along. And it was very challenging in the fact that, again, they weren't raised the way mine were. If I said, no, you don't do that, my kids didn't do that. Or if they did, they got the consequences. When he was saying, no, don't do that, they did it. And they didn't get any consequences. So it was really... really in my face, really challenging. I thought, well, I'm not raising the children. He's asked me to go to him if I have any issues or any problems, because he wanted to be the father and go that way and just allow me to be a support. And so I took that on board. That's what he wanted. That's what he needed for his happiness, I guess. And so my role became supporting my partner rather than raising these children. Although I was a parent figure in that family, in the mixed family, I wasn't actually raising the children. So the best way I could help these children was by supporting their father. And that's what my goal was. One of the aspects in there was one of the children wanted to borrow some money from Dad. And he came to me and he goes, oh, they already owe this much and this, and you know, they're just not this and they're not that. And he had a bit of a whinge and a bitch about it. And I sort of said to him, well, borrowing the money is not a problem. They can borrow the money. But I said, what I question is, what are you teaching that child? Said, this child, and he's a teenager now, said, but that child has learnt from the word go how to live in credit, how to live in debt, I should say, because he's always borrowed money. He's never ever saved, or he's never ever had a goal to want to save. So this child or this person has been taught that you live in credit. You always owe money. And I said, that is what you're looking at for teaching your child. Is that empowering your child? Is that trusting your intuition? Now, straight away, because he came to me, I knew that his gut was saying, no, don't do it. You just don't do that. He needs to save it. I need to empower him to get him on the right path. So straight away, he was umming and ahhing, which meant his intuition, it wasn't sitting right. He also knew that he needed to empower his child, because just handing over money is not empowering. That's where I went, okay, I needed to support my husband, my partner. I wasn't going to go, you know, do this or do that. I wanted him to understand what his intuition was saying and the best way he could help his child. And that's when I said, so what are you teaching your child by handing this money over? And that became a little bit of a mantra. What are you teaching your child? Because every time something would happen and it would go against his gut feeling, he would then ask, what am I teaching this child? And that gave him the understanding of how he could empower his child and how he could help them go forward. From there on, of course, then the child starts to learn and the child starts to take on board different aspects. I watch my all three of my kids. I've watched, even watch my son. I don't see it as much in my son. You see it in more of an action than an emotion. But I watch my girls with their children, and I've got 8 grandchildren now, and I watch how they are trusting their intuition to raise their children and how they're empowering their child to trust themselves. So it's beautiful to watch. It's beautiful to see. And they're supporting each other as in partners. They're supporting each other as they do it. We've gone through a lot. And one of the biggest takeaways for this is really you've got to trust you. You can read other people's books. You can get an understanding of everything else. But you have to trust the feelings that are coming from you. The tweaks, the understanding, the little thought patterns that you have, that something doesn't quite feel right or something, you know, it's just not there. You've got to trust that. With intuition, it's all about interpreting the signs. And when we have those funny little feelings and those funny little issues, it is about interpreting them. Now, we're not going to get it right 100% of the time. Trust me, I don't get it right 100% of the time, but I am aware of it. If I don't read the interpretation properly, then okay, I've got to learn from that. but I am aware of it. And I often say now, it just doesn't feel right. Something's not quite right. I don't know what it is, but something doesn't feel right. And it's okay to say that. It's okay to say, I'm not sure what it is. Even empowering your child, and you just sort of go, look, I've got this funny feeling. How do you feel about that? Let your child open up. Let your teenager say, you know, this or that. Because you do that for them now, as they go out into that world, they're going to do it themselves. They're going to get to that stage where they're walking into a party and they go, oh, there's something off about this. Something doesn't feel right. And they're listening to what their gut's saying. They're listening to their intuition. They can ignore it, and so be it. But they're becoming more and more aware of it, and that's the main thing. Then when you're in a mixed family, look, divorce and mixed families are becoming just part of the norm nowadays. But when you're in these mixed families, don't expect that child to be your child. You can love them like your own child, but they're going to have different aspects of them. Be mindful of that. The best thing you can do for that child is support their partner, support your partner, support their father, their mother, their grandmother. No, you know, their parent. That's what I meant to say. The takeaway for all this. So, when parenting, there's so many variables in life. So your child's life and the circumstances around you. We look at the past, you know, what our parents and our parents' parents have done. We look at our environment, what's happening with that. We look at the child's situation, what they're growing up in. I mean, a child growing up at the moment during COVID is very different from my age when I grew up as a child and you just ran around and played with worms and all sorts of things. You can't go by what's happening externally. The only way you can go is by looking for the answers inside of you. It's not about other people's beliefs and understandings. To get the right answer, you need to ask your intuition. You need to ask your spirit what the right answer is and bravely carry through with that. Because the benefits for your child will be integrated over many, many generations. I assure you, I watch my grandchildren and I can see the differences in them because they're being empowered to be them and to listen and trust themselves. So remember, other people can give you great ideas, but you don't have to follow them word for word or action for action. You can blend their ideas with yours to determine if it sits right with you, if it sits right with your family, and if it sits right with your circumstances. So the secret to parenting is trusting yourself, trust your intuition, empowering your child so they trust theirs, and supporting your partner. No matter what happens and what other people think, follow your intuition, and so will your child. Because once they follow their intuition, they are on their life journey, on their life purpose. If you want more advice or tools for trusting your intuition, subscribe to the podcast, follow me on Facebook, Instagram or Twitter, or jump onto the website www.intuitivenature.com.au and check out the blogs and free resources. Also, I've got a couple of Facebook groups. One's called Emotional Mastery and one's called Intuitive Personal Development for Women. Now, it's for women because I tend to talk more as a woman. I tend to talk more or relate more to other women. So remember, we are all naturally intuitive. It is part of human nature. It is our intuitive nature. I'm Susan Jane, the Intuitist from Intuitive Nature, and I thank you for listening. Bye for now.